Good morning and welcome to Lanier. We're glad all of you are here for worship this morning. It's a beautiful Sunday morning in which to worship our Lord, and we're delighted that you've chosen to be with us today. I hope every one of you will sign the attendance register as it's found in the black folders close to the center aisle there, that we might have a record of your worship with us this morning. A few words of announcement. The youth and the Promise Keepers will meet this afternoon as usual. We want to say thank you this morning for all those who've been helping us clean up the grounds here, take down some trees, et cetera, to get ready for construction. We've got a final meeting on the permit. We say final with crossed fingers on Thursday morning. And so everything seems to be falling in line for the construction to begin. The last of the trees will be removed tomorrow. So we're feeling really good about how things are happening. Thank you for all your volunteer work that you've done to save us a lot of money in this process. The Women's Bible Studies will meet on Tuesday at 1 o'clock and on Wednesday at 6 o'clock this week. So please come join us, women, for those times. A week from Tuesday is the runoff election. We need volunteers to help host the election. Out on the Narthex kiosk, you will find a sign-up sheet there for times to come and be with us and help us host those who come for the election on the 21st. We of the church want to extend Christian sympathy to Michael Smith in the death of his son, Jason. The funeral will be this afternoon at 2 o'clock over at Ingram's Funeral Home. And certainly we remember Michael and his family. Again, welcome to all of you. This is a good congregation on this summer day.
Please stand and join us in singing our opening hymn, Come Thou Almighty King.
Affirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us unite now in a time of prayer. First of all, some moments of silent prayer and meditation. Almighty and everlasting God, we come in acknowledgement of your divine majesty to worship you on this Trinity Sunday. Enlarge our minds, O Lord, to see the glory of the eternal Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, alive and reigning now and forevermore. God, you're faithful and unchanging. Enlighten us with the wisdom of your truth and draw us more deeply into the gracious reality of your love. Lord, we sense how much we need your guiding presence. With all the issues we face daily, we pray that you will give special wisdom to us, and particularly those who give us leadership, from war and fighting, to half-truths and downright dishonesty, to economic woes and a continuing pandemic. Lord, lead us out of the wilderness. Help us to lean on you and trust your answers. We pray for those of our congregation who grieve today, especially Michael Smith and his family. Bring comfort to them, Lord. We ask your healing hand upon those who are ill and undergo treatments. Give healing and enable hope, O God. We pray for your church and the work that we do here to prepare for the future. Strengthen our leadership and make our decisions wise ones. We also pray for our cherished partners in ministry around the world. We experience kinship with so many, and ask your blessing upon each. To God the Father, who loves and accepts us, to God the Son, who by grace has loosed us from our sins, and to God the Holy Spirit, who extends to our hearts and beyond us the inspired love of God, and to the one true God, may there be majesty and glory for all time and eternity, through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You know, from time to time, we have special needs in our church family. And we have one of our members who's undergoing some rather hard times, and we hope that as a congregation we can assist her. And so if you have a mind to, or a desire rather, to help her, if you just simply make a gift to our benevolence fund, we will be able to provide food and some assistance to her until she gets the medical help that she needs. So I hope you'll keep that in mind as we receive the offering today. Our Lord said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." Let us worship God now with our tithes and our offerings. Accept, O Lord, the offerings which these your people give unto you, and help us as your congregation to use these gifts to the growth of your kingdom, to share the wondrous news of the gospel. For we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trial and storm. What height of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled in striving seas. My comforter, my all in all,
just words to me. I don't know what they mean. But it doesn't keep me from driving my car. Just like when you get into a car, you know, you trust that whoever's driving will get you where you need to go, right? You don't understand about the car, about steering and stuff, but you just know that if you get in it, you'll go, right? So I bring this up because today is Trinity Sunday. So Trinity means three, basically, right? And Trinity is Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So I made a little triangle. So we have the Father at the top, who is God, right? All creator. He created us. He's the sustainer of the world, sustains us. Then we have Jesus, his Son, right, who came to the world. He died for our sins. And then we have the Holy Spirit, which is given to us when we say we believe that Jesus is God's Son. But when Jesus was here, God wasn't anything less. God was still God. He didn't change who he was. Just like when we have the Holy Spirit in our heart, that's God's Spirit within us, but God is still doing what God does, right? Just like I am Miss Leslie on Wednesday nights, but I'm still Leslie. I'm still who I am, right? I'm a mom to my kids, and I'm a daughter to my parents, but I'm still, that's just parts of who I am. It doesn't make me any less when I'm in another role, right? Does that make sense? Yeah, kind of. It's kind of like an egg. I have an egg here. I had to take it off of my home from, hopefully it's still in time. Yes. And so we have an egg, right? And when you open the egg, we have the egg. We have three parts. We have the shell, right? And we have the yolk. And we have the white stuff, right? So you can mix them all up and have a scrambled egg, but it's still an egg, right? Or if you just need the yolks, you can still take them apart, but it's still part of the egg, right? The egg is still a whole egg, even though it has three different parts. Just like water, you know, there's water you can drink, right? It's liquid. What's another way that we can, that water is formed? Like ice. When it's frozen, it's still water, it's just frozen. Or when it's hot, what happens to water when it gets hot?
It turns
into
hot water.
And it turns into steam, right? So it's the same thing, it's still water. So I say all of this to say that even though we fully don't understand God, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that's okay. We can trust that God is who he says he is. And God is an amazing, amazing power in each and every one of our lives, in every single one of those parts. As God the Father, as God the Son, and as God the Holy Spirit. So we may not truly understand. We kind of do, but we don't fully understand. But we will someday. Just don't know when. Maybe not until we actually are in heaven. And we're like, I get it now. Until then, we just have to trust. Okay? Let's say a prayer. Father, we are so grateful and thankful, Lord, for your Father, for you, the Father, for the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God. And Lord, we just thank you that we can don't always have to understand, Lord, but we can always just trust in you. And we thank you for that. Lord, help us to make good choices this week and help us remember no matter what we say and no matter what we do, you will always love us and always be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Again, welcome to each of you. I'm glad you're here with us. We have several visitors, and we always enjoy having you here, and we hope you'll come very, very often. I want to say a word of gratitude to Bill Brothers for filling into me, for me rather, last Sunday while Nancy was still in the hospital. She thankfully is out and was here at early service this morning. She's doing very nicely. I'm grateful to Bill for doing a tremendous job last week. The rest of the story was I had planned on being on vacation this week, and Bill was going to preach for me. Bill's all ready, and Bill's going to preach for us again today. And you're in for a real treat. I've already heard him at the early service. And so, Bill, after the reading of the scripture, we look forward to hearing that good sermon once again. Thank you.
Today's scripture is from the book of John, chapter 16, verses 12 through 15. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I have to get to the beginning again. I was stuck in the end. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Very good. We don't have to do that one again. You guys learned your lesson from last week, didn't you?
Yeah. Yes.
Well, here we go. Holy Spirit, part two. Last week we heard who the Holy Spirit is. We saw a great video about it, and we actually learned a new word. Does everybody remember the word? Okay, let's say it. Ruach. Make sure you clear your throat at the end. Right. Ruach. And that word meant a lot of things. Breath, wind, but was summed up in energy. Right? God's essence. That's what they called it. God's essence. It's his energy. And so we love how that came about. But I also love my wife's, Terry's, interpretation of that. God in us. I think that's really important to remember that the Holy Spirit is God in us. You know, we heard talk a lot about the Holy Trinity at the children's moment. You know, you have God the Father who loves us as children. God the Son who walked with us. And then the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit who is in us. This week, we hear another name for him. The Spirit of Truth. Now, the first thing that popped in my head when I came up with that title was a saying that we've all heard. There's three sides to every story. There's your side, there's my side, and then somewhere there's the truth. Right? We've all heard that saying. Somewhere in the middle there's the truth. And this is because when we have events in our lives or we hear facts, we interpret them through our lives' experiences. Right? No two lives are the same. And this is also true when we read Scripture. When we read Scripture, we read it through a lens of what's going on in our lives, what's going on in the world at that time. Right? The words don't change in the Bible, but your experiences change the intent of that message. This is why we call it the living word. The living word, because it doesn't stay static. It lives day to day with you. This is why it's important that we call on the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Truth. This is how the message translated. The Spirit of Truth, he will take you by the hand and guide you into the truth, all the truth there is. He guides you. He takes you by the hand and he guides you. You know, last week I told you that he is here to teach us and lead us, but not lead us like in follow the leader, right? It's just not to blindly. It is, he is here to teach us like a rabbi, the teacher. He is here to open our minds. And we need to call on him as we read Scripture so that we can hear the truth at that moment. You notice I said, I didn't say read. I said hear. Tozer, a theologist, would tell you that you should never read the Bible. You should hear the Bible. Hear the Bible. When you open up, you should be prepared to hear the message. When you open the Bible, you're not just reading words on the page. You need to empty yourself. And let the Holy Spirit guide you through that interpretation. You let the Holy Spirit fill you so that you can hear God's voice. You can hear Jesus' voice. One of the things I always love to mention, and Jesus does this a lot in, when he's talking, right? He'll say, you hear the word you. I want you to do this. I expect you to follow this. I expect you. And you think, maybe he's just talking to the disciples. Nope, he's not. He's talking to you. Right? He's talking to you. When you see that word you in the Bible, that's you. That's not John. That's not Peter. Bartholomew, who we never ever talk about. It's you. He's talking to you. And the Holy Spirit is here to make you realize that Scripture is talking to you. That's why we need to hear the Bible. We need to hear the Scripture. As we heard in our reading, the Holy Spirit only tells us things that come from God. Don't you love that? The Holy Spirit will lead us, and He will not lead us astray. He leads you in the ways of God, in the ways of Jesus. He tells you what it's like to walk and mature in our faith. Now, as we heard in this reading, this is a solemn part of Jesus' message as he's talking to the disciples. This is a very solemn reading. He's preparing the disciples for his departure, both his departures. First, the crucifixion, and then the ascension. He's preparing them because he has to leave them. He's preparing them for his death. He's preparing them for the hardships that are going to follow. He's letting them in on all the secrets of his mission and of theirs and ours. We're on a mission. They were on a mission. We are on a mission. We are on Jesus' mission. This is the secrets that he's giving them as he's preparing them for him to leave them. He's warning them and us to trust, not to trust anyone except the Holy Spirit. In verses 8 through 11, before our reading, Jesus tells the disciples about the Spirit and how it will show them the true world of sin, the true world that follows the wrong master. You know, I always like to say that the enemy likes to keep us blinded. He likes to put that rose-colored glasses on us so that we don't always see the ugliness of this world. He likes to turn us away from the homeless. He likes to turn us away from the hungry. He likes to turn us away from those who are sick. He wants us to know that there's nothing wrong in this world. Well, the Holy Spirit will show us it's not a pretty world out there. And we know that. But we see more and more of it as we walk in our faith. And he does all of this through us. The Holy Spirit is here to guide us through this ugliness. He is here to keep us focused on the true path. The true path. In this day and age of easy access to anything and everything, it's easy to follow the wrong path. It's easy to get lost, as Ed said in his prayer, in the wilderness. Easy access to news, shopping online now, right? We have everything at our fingertips almost. It's easy to lose our way, and the Spirit is here. The Spirit of truth is here to keep us focused on the right path. Especially when we are tempted to put on those rose-colored glasses. The Spirit is here to guide us in continuing in Jesus' ministry. That's really the important thing, is to remember that He is here to guide us and to help us walk in the same way that Jesus did in His earthly ministry. To give us the courage to do God's work. He doesn't work against us, but with us. And he will only give us what we can take at that moment. He only gives us what we can understand at that moment. But he doesn't leave us there. He encourages us, strengthens us, leads us into places that make us uncomfortable. He pushes us to do more than we think we are capable of doing. And he does this so that we rely on him, that we rely on God, that we go back to Scripture and find out what this means. He doesn't leave us in our comfortable area. I'm a good example, right? I never planned to be up here preaching. I didn't plan to become a pastor. I don't think anybody hardly ever plans for something like that. I was comfortable sitting in the pews, minding my own business. I was comfortable not having to worry about calling people or taking on the responsibility of Holy Communion or doing church reports. I was comfortable with all that, not doing that. But God has another plan. God does not leave you where you're at. He said, Bill. I said, what? He says, I want you to preach. I went, who? He says, you. I said, who? He goes, you. No. Right? He doesn't leave you in your comfort zone. He pushes you to do more. To do more for God. To do more for the people around you. It's less about you and more about everybody else. We would do well to heed Jesus' words in the verses 8 through 11. We need to heed his words of the sinful world so that we don't fall into it. We need to heed his word to see that the world is not in a righteous place. We need to heed his word that it is following the wrong master. But we must understand that this is no whimsical journey that we're on. When we accepted this life, this Christian life, he is warning us that there are going to be trials and tribulations. This is why the Holy Spirit is here. Jesus knew we couldn't do this alone, that we needed an advocate. We needed that Ruach, God's energy. Now, earlier I mentioned about the three sides to every story, right? And I was reading an article about that because I really wanted to know where it came from. Well, the guy who wrote the article says, I believe it came from Aesop's fable, The Mule. Let me read the fable. A mule had grown fat and wanton, on too great of an allowance of corn, was one day jumping and kicking about. At length, cocking up her tail, she exclaimed, my mother was a racer, and I'm quite as good as she ever was. But soon, exhausted with her galloping and frisking, she remembered all at once that her father was but a donkey. So we see here that the mule thought of herself as a racer, right? Just was better than anything that you could think of. But then she shortly realized the truth, that she was just a donkey. The actual moral of the fable was, be sure of your pedigree before you boast about it. The Spirit is here to remind us who we are. He is here to remind us of our pedigree, that we are truly not the citizens of this world anymore, that we are the children of God. The Spirit of truth shows the true world around us, but it also reminds us of the love of God for us and in us. Last week we heard about the Spirit that still lingers today in dark places, waiting to bring life where there once was death. And he's going to take some of us and move us into those dark places. Because he wants us to carry that good news of God's love and mercy and grace. Today we are hearing about the Spirit is sent by God through our faith in Jesus to guide in all the truth there is. Our mission, if we choose to accept it, is to empty ourselves of what the world has promised so that we can be filled with the Spirit of truth and the promises of God. Now, that sounded kind of like a Mission Impossible movie, didn't it? It isn't. It is the life that we have been promised when we accepted God's grace. We aren't going to be secret agents. No. We're not going to be that secret agent man. We're going to be over agents. We're going to be transparent. We're going to be out there spreading the good news, showing people what it's like to love unconditionally, to give mercy, to give grace. The Spirit will lead us to be God's hands and feet. So let us not be afraid. You know, we take the writing from 2 Timothy. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. The Spirit of truth is in us. It is time for us to let Him take control. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, we come to you on Holy Trinity weekend as we ask that you empty us so that we can be filled with your Holy Spirit, you Ruach, so that we will have the energy to move us in the direction that God wants us to go, to keep us on that path, to keep it on the straight and narrow. And so, Lord, we ask that you fill us with that Holy Spirit and guide us. Let us see with your eyes, let us reach with your hands, and let us feel with your heart. And we ask all this in your Son's name. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
We want to say thank you to Bill for inspiring us today and reminding us of the place of the Holy Trinity, and particularly the Holy Spirit living in us. Let's join together now and sing the closing song.
Love one another, sin no more. And all the people said,
Amen.